Good evening. I'm Victoria Dengle, the Executive Director of the General Society of Mechanics and Tradesmen, and I am pleased to welcome you to the final lecture in Season 4 of the Artisan Lecture Series. The Artisan Lecture Program is supported in part by public funds from the New York City Department of Cultural Affairs in partnership with the City Council. Generous support is also provided by the following sponsors: the McQuesten Companies, Peter Pennoia Architects, Ferguson and Shema Mamian Architects, and John B. Murray Architect. And for those of you not familiar with the General Society of Mechanics and Tradesmen, we were founded in 1785 by the skilled craftsmen of the city. Today, our 229-year-old organization continues to serve and improve the quality of life of the people of the city of New York through our cultural and educational activities and programs, which include our tuition-free Mechanics Institute, our 176-year-old lecture series, and the library of the General Society. And you're in the room of the library, the main reading room of the library is where you are. The Artisan Lecture Series continues a distinguished tradition of General Society's public lectures, which started in 1837. The Artisan Lecture Series pays tribute to the art of craftsmanship by featuring internationally known master artisans who describe the intricacies of their specialized crafts. The lecture will be followed by a short wine and cheese reception that we hope you will be able to stay for. And to introduce our lecturer for this evening, Karen Taylor, our program director, will do that.
Good evening. Welcome to the General Society. I'm delighted you can be here. Before introducing our speaker, I just want to acknowledge the contribution of Camille Wyatt, who has curated the whole series, and to express our appreciation for her work. We are absolutely delighted. Yes. We are so delighted this evening that we have Sandrine Bernard, Executive Vice President of Solitus USA, and she is here to discuss the process of fine lace making. Renowned manufacturer Solitus is respected worldwide for its exquisite luxury laces and known for the wealth and diversity of its lace patterns, extensive color palette, and cutting-edge innovation. The world's top fashion houses turn to Solitus laces as a resource and inspiration for their creations, including Alexander McQueen, Chanel, Christian Dior, Dolce & Gabbana, Donna Karan, Karl Lagerfeld, Marc Jacob, Vera Wang, and many, many more top designers. Also, for those of you who are fortunate enough to recently see The Great Gatsby, those stunning costumes that were featured in the film were designed and created with Solitus lace, and they also won designer Catherine Martin the 2014 Oscar for costume design. Sandrine Bernard has worked for Solitus USA, a subsidiary of Solitus SAS, since 2006. Headquartered with production in France, Solitus produces fine lace textiles, supplying the ready-to-wear, haute couture, bridal lingerie, home decor, and film theater industries around the world. Ms. Bernard oversees the New York and Los Angeles offices. She began her career in Germany as a brand manager for Pimkie, a European fashion line, and then worked for the intimate apparel division of Chevignon. In 1997, she joined the Pionier Group, where during her 3 years there, worked successively in the areas of export management, marketing, and finally head of sales. Relocating to New York in 2004, she worked as a consultant for well-known fashion and cosmetic brands such as Chanel, L'Oreal, and Kering, formerly known as PPR. Sandrine Bernard is a graduate of Schema Business School in Lille, France. I am so delighted, as I mentioned before, on behalf of the General Society, to be able to introduce to you Sandrine Bernard.
Thank Thank you. Good evening. I'm very happy to be here. Thank you for welcoming us and to welcoming Solstice here in this beautiful place. First of all, I would like to know what do you know about lace? I saw a beautiful dress by Valentino made with our lace tonight, so it's amazing, but I don't know what does lace mean for you? Huh? Just a general question.
Femininity?
Yes, definitely.
Huh. Beautiful clothes.
Okay. Okay, good one. Are you French? Okay. Huh. So I think that Solstice lace is a little bit of
all of that.
So you may not know Solstice because we do B2B, so we are working with all the major designers. So we have a few examples here to show you that you have been exposed to Solstice recently. Huh? So in the middle, you have a Kate Middleton wedding. So the dress was made with Solstice laces. And so a picture of The Great Gatsby. You mentioned that before, which was something very big for Solstice, a very nice story, and a lot of celebrities and red carpets. So Solstice is very, it can be found every day in the newspaper, magazines, and on TV, definitely. Huh? So tonight I will first speak about the lace history, where is the lace coming from. Then we will move to Solstice to give you more information about who we are, what we do, how we do it. And finally, we give you a few examples of our product, a beautiful product, and the uses of our laces. So first of all, what is lace? We say that lace is fabric around walls. So to be more precise, it's more open work fabric where combination of open space and dense textures form design. So where is the lace is coming? So we have trace of lace in the old Egyptian time, so that was the first lace traces. Then I will say that the 16th century is where really the lace is coming up. So Venice in Italy is showing pictures of laces, I think because it was like a major trade city, so it's and very rich, so it's where we saw laces. At that time, of course, lace was handmade. And so mostly, which is very surprising, the lace was, the men were wearing laces as big cuffs, big collars. Then they moved to women for the wedding dress and warping the woman in the lace. So the lace was found as well in the home decor at that time. So through the 18th century, lace became increasingly delicate and fine. And the lace was representing the wealth and the delicacy and the good taste. So today we are going to focus on liver lace. Sorry for the image and for my very strong French accent. I hope you understand. So liver lace. So it's an interesting story. So in the 19th century, early beginning of 19th century, in England, John Heathcote was looking at the fingers of the woman doing the lace, and he was dreaming about a machine, a loom. We can do that. At the same time, the Joseph Marie Jacquard invented the Jacquard machine. So the combination of all this knowledge and trying to find a way to replicate the handmade lace with loom came in 1804, and Mr. Livers developed the Livers lace. The Livers lace was invented in UK. Then the machine, the loom, was smuggled to the north of France through the English Channel. It's the reason why today the Livers lace is made in the north of France, close to Calais. So Livers lace is known as well as dentelle de Calais, lace of Calais. So, So to move to solstice, here are the picture of the four family makers we created solstice in 1974. The history of solstice is very deep. So these family makers started their business in 1870-79, but in the 60s they really suffer from three different elements. First, there was like a Pope law. The Catholic had to go to church with mantillas, the veil on the head, and in the 60s the Pope decided they can go without. So it was 80% of the lace business which was going down from a day to another one, which was for us like a big challenge. At the same time, it was the courage trend. So courage is everything but no lace at all. And the third one was the feminist movement. So in France, and you could see the women like burning their bra in the street. So the femininity was not there. So the lace maker was really struggling, and they decided, okay, so our major market is France, or close to France, we have to go abroad. But how can we do that? So we have to join all our force and our knowledge to go abroad. So that's what they did, and I'm very impressed by what they did at that time. So making solstice like a very huge company, which selling lace in 80 countries around the world today, and being like the leader of the Livers lace, and I'm very proud to work with for this company. So we are going to show you a small movie to explain each step of the production of lace. I think that the picture will show you better than talk.
Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you for being here in one of the most renowned solstice showroom. My name is Vincent. I'm a French student. I study international trade relations, and my mission today is to offer you to discover the French savoir-faire of lace production. As you may know, French laces are recognized for being the best quality laces in the world. So let's start the trip. All starts with the patterns. Issued from the design department or received from designers, fashion specialists, they are the soul of the lace. More than 250 patterns are available in solstice. The designers transpose the pattern on a graph paper, as you will see right now. Then they digitalize the pattern in order to translate it in numbers of lines, which will become the laces. Designers have to work fast because of the changing demands of designers, but also to create an original pattern. Stage, the patterns are translated on cardboard called jacquards. With a game of horse and foot, the lever, which we will see in stage 4, will read those jacquards to realize the patterns with the laces. Around 3,000 jacquards are needed to realize only one pattern. Like a pianist, this man reads the model and presses buttons to feed the carton. This old method is mostly used to renovate used cardboard, whereas the new method, this one as you can see, is used to create new jacquards, which is faster but also easier. The jacquard binder is a traditional method to interlink the cardboards. As I said, 3,000 jacquards are needed to realize only one pattern. Are part of the most important components of the levers. They are composed of 300 laces each, divided in 300 discs. Here the man is just putting one per one lace in one per one disc. 150 meters of lace are wrapped in each caisson. 36 caissons are needed in one lever. Then, they are installed in bases which will be put on the lever. This man is checking each disc one after the other to be sure that there is only one lace per disc. Here we can see the preparation of reels of tulle. 10,000 laces are wrapped on the reel. Those laces will create the tulle, the background of the final lace. If you have to memorize one word, it is lever. This massive machine, large of 5 meters, weighing around 10 tons and old of 100 years, is the heart of the lace. Here you can see the lever reading the jacquards, which will permit to realize a pattern with laces. The lever produces 500 square meters per week by pieces of 10 meters length and 5 meters wide. When a piece is done, the tullists, people who work on the lever, here we can see, place off the lace and break it back to the first checking. We will see it now. In the world of lace, men are working on machines and women on finished lace. Here, they are verifying the quality of the lace, One of those women changes around 30 square meters per day. As you can see right here, they are the only ones who can see the defaults on the lace and then repair them. When the lace is checked, it is sent to dyeing in specialized company in northern France, specialized in lace dyeing. After the dyeing, the lace is cut in different sizes according to the needs and requirements of designers. The women can cut around 50 miles of lace in a week, 8 miles per day. Here the black lace is a pattern ordered by Dolce & Gabbana. They order around 8 miles of this lace per month. After being cut, the lace is checked one more time to be sure that the lace is perfect. And one more time, if a problem is revealed, the specialist repairs it immediately. The lace dressing is very important. The value of the lace can be doubled or tripled. The goal of this stage is to magnify the lace by re-embroidering the patterns. It demands a lot of concentration and patience, but look at the result, it is wonderful. In the lace dressing, you can also add pearls, strass, like Swarovski for example. The most expensive lace sold by Solstice was around $4,000 per square meter. Manual labor represents 90% of the price of the lace. The last stage is easy. You fold the lace and send it to designers. Now the show can begin. How long have you been working in the lace industry?
Well, it's been 21 years.
And how long does it take to master a lever?
We keep learning every day. You can master it easily. It requires a specific knowledge. It is not something anyone can do or learn, even if you work in the lace industry. For example, a preparator cannot work on a lever.
How do you feel when you see Sossi's patterns on fashion events?
I am proud, very proud. For example, I did the lace of Kate Middleton's wedding dress on the lever, just right here.
Lace companies are rare nowadays, so you must be proud to participate in the Northern France heritage.
Of course, moreover, it is a knowledge which gets lost. There are no more masters, and it is sometimes hard to train young people. And unfortunately, I'm afraid that in the future, stylists might get extinct.
Do you think it's a knowledge not recognized enough?
Recognized, yes, but in Northern France, because here are the lace companies, you know. But in the world, I don't know if they imagine all of this.
here it is. I hope you learned a lot about the French savoir-faire of lace production. Thank you for watching and listening. And if you have any questions, I will be pleased to answer you. Now, enjoy.
We move to the design. So Solstice has about 6,000 permanent patterns in the showrooms, and about 30,000 different colors. So let's start with design number one. Not just kidding, we are not going through the 6,000. So a few examples and the way we work in the showroom. So on the left, floral design. On the right, geometric design. Most of the time, people have in mind floral design. So lace is mostly floral. But actually, we have a lot of different design, and here it's a good example. So we can show you, and you can look at the headers after, you can touch it, you can see the design, and feel the quality, and of course we can answer to your question looking at the lace as well. Huh? So in our showroom, generally, when we welcome a designer, he's going to ask for floral or geometric because they have already something in mind. So one of the most popular laces, Livernois, is Chantilly. Huh? So it's a creme de la creme. I have to say it come deep in the 17th century, and the Chantilly lace is very characteristic because you have like a lot of design and details, and you can see on the left all the details are like surrounded by the yarn outlining the design. So it's the most exquisite and the most expensive laces. Mm-hmm. And on the right, you have something very different and very heavy, but very popular as well. It's called guipure. So it's something very different. It's not livers, but it's something we do. So it's embroidery on the special non-woven fabric. And with a chemical treatment after the embroidery, the background just disappear. And we keep only the beautiful design. Huh? And typically the lace, the guipure is 100% cotton. Huh? So as you saw in the little movie, so this is a lot of embellished laces. Huh? So it can be cording, as on the is shown on the left. This kind of laces, it's called as well Alençon. It's liver lace with a cording. The cording can be machine made or by hand. It's very, very popular for the brides, for the wedding dress. On the right, we have another design here. You can see the details of all the elements. All the elements on this one are Swarovski's. Element, so and it is done by hand. So Solstice need to be creative. So every year we are presenting about 250 designs, twice a year actually at Première Vision in Paris, and so we need to bring something to our designer to inspire them to give them another idea of the lace. So here we have two different examples. It was shown in Paris in February. On the left, it's flocking on lace with like deep, vibrant colors. And on the right is a silicone treatment. So with silicone, we give like some texture, some relief to the lace. Another section in our showroom, and something which is very popular, is metallic laces. Could be floral or geometric. So we have different kind of metallic laces using different kind of threads. So we are using a lurex. Lurex yarn can be dyed, and can have like the beautiful fuchsia color. Or we use a yarn we call that laminette. It's a round metallic yarn. And we can be gold, silver, copper, and give like a very interesting effect and a very special hand to the lace. And the last addition to Solstice, and where we're trying to bring something different, is adding few natural fiber in our laces. Most of the laces are made with polyamide, and then we can use cotton, rayon, polyester, and silk. And here we added like linen to our lace, which was something different, bamboo to our lace as well, and all this kind of material, and as well working with wool and cashmere to give like very, very different hand and something the designer really appreciates. As you saw in the little movie, the lace came in different widths. It can be like all over to make the big dresses and being like small trims to be a details on the garment. So here you have a few examples of different trims. So a few examples of the last collections where Solstice lace was shown on the runway. From the left to the right, Monique, so Bridal Market, which is an important market for us. So on the left, Monique Lullier. In the middle, Vera Wang. And on the right, Carolina Herrera. Couture is a big market as well. Here we decided to show you an example of Chanel haute couture collection. So it's very exclusive for tonight because Chanel doesn't want us to communicate at all on their creation. So this one is very interesting. So actually the lace was laminated to give this different shine color effect. And then the trims were woven together to recreate a fabric. So ready to wear. So we have two different examples. On the left, Leila Rose, American designer. And on the right, Dolce Gabbana, last final runway show with metallic beautiful lace. So lingerie is another important market. So we work with many different designers. On the left is RS, so part of Chanel division, so group. And on the right is Agent Provocateur, based in UK. So accessories is something is important as well. More and more designers are working with laces. Here you have two examples. The bag is Louboutin. So the white shoes are Givenchy, and the lace with silicone is another designer, a Spanish designer. So entertainment industry. So we spoke about that before. Recently, The Great Gatsby, we work a lot with Catherine Martin. We were very proud for her to have the Oscar. And we deliver for this movie 1,400 meters of laces only for this movie, which was a lot. And mostly beaded, embellished with feather, ribbon, metallic part, crystal. So it was amazing. Twilight as well, the camera designed the dress for Bella with Solstice laces. And recently, La Belle et la Bête, which is Beauty and the Beast, French movie, all the costumes were made with Solstice lace. Solstice Home is something we're working, and we are very proud of this project. You may know the Greystone Mansion in Beverly Hills. So we were very proud to work with a designer last fall and to have all these different parts of the mansion covered with Solstice lace. The wall, the sofa, the lights, the mirror, So everything was 30 slices. So thank you very much. So I will be happy to answer your questions. Yes?
So it's
something we do.
If a designer had a specific pattern that they created and they wanted you to make for them, would you do that?
Yes, of course. And it's part of our creating development. We do a lot of special development for the big name. First, the designer has to understand that there is a cost to develop a new design, as you can see in the little movie. So it can run anywhere between 4,000 and 10,000 euros just to develop the design. Mm-hmm. But we do a lot, and we did like amazing project with Chanel, with Alexander McQueen, so with Michael Kors, so something we do.
So who owns the design when they create the, if they make a sketch of the design and then you create the pattern for it, mm-hmm. and the computer graphics that create it, who actually owns that design? Is it the designer or you?
Okay, so all our designs are copywriting, of course, and very protected. The reason why, if you go on our website, we don't show much, because we have to protect our design. So when a designer is developing a design, it's depends on the deal together. Okay, so each time is something very different, because the design can be like wow, and we want to really to have it in our collection not in the coming year, because it's the designer want to use it, but maybe in a few years. So there is a deal and an agreement with the designer.
I see.
So we developed a beautiful peak of feathers design for Alexander McQueen, which now is a part of the collection. We developed a beautiful King of Heart design for Jean-Paul Gaultier, which is part of our collection now. So there's many examples like that.
Thank you.
When your designers design and you sell it, let's say, to Chanel, do they tell you you cannot sell it to any other designer?
So there's an agreement. So we grant exclusivity. It's our design, but we can grant exclusivity to designer. It's a matter of quantities. They have to commit to quantities, because of course it's our business to sell our product. So they are committing to a certain quantity, and they get an exclusivity for a time period, usually.
Because I wouldn't think if I were Chanel, I would want to see that lace on other people's dresses.
This is what we do, exactly.
What is
tulle? Tulle is the background of the lace, you know, the net. That's tulle. We do, but it's not a huge part of our business.
Sandrine, in terms of apprentices, what the man said who was at the lever, what the machine again, the loom that he was at, and he was speaking about people coming and following and learning the craft. Is there anything that Solstice does to nurture new talent?
So that's a big question for Solstice. So as the tourist, the man operating the loom, said, it takes about 5 years to have somebody able to operate the loom by himself. So it's a long process. So the young generation are not really interesting in France in this kind of job. So I have to say, but we try to find some talented people, because it's really a talent. I'm so impressed, and to see how they work, it's like amazing. So they created a special school to have these young people joining the lace industry and starting as apprenticeship to be there in a few years and to continue this to be Tulis and to be there because it's part of the French heritage and we really have to continue. That's very tough. There is some, but we need to keep only the good one, huh? Because less doesn't suffer mediocrity. That's not possible. Yes?
Thank you. In addition to the artisans that you're training to run the looms, actual lace designs, do you have designers on staff? Or do people design for you by contract? Or do people submit things that you'll purchase? How does that work?
So we have a studio, a development studio, with a designer on staff. But we work a lot with freelancers. They come to us and they have like sketches. And so they show their work. And if we are interesting, we buy the design to them. Yes? So the veil, okay. So the veil usually is used for the bride. So it comes on the head and going down. And so we did a beautiful one actually for Camille for her wedding. She was like wearing like a solstice veil. And so it basically is usually it's like trims around the tulle. And depend on what you want, it like, can be very, very long and or short, and depend.
Is that what's very popular with wearing veils just on the hats, not necessarily for?
So I think there is, in French, there is another word for that. It's called voilette. I don't know in English, but it's the shorter part. And we have a few designers. We are like doing like kind of hat with small veil, just in front of the face. And I think it's very beautiful. It's very chic. Yeah. I agree with you.
I have a question. Lace is very. Hi, I'm right here. Okay. Lace is very delicate. So how would you pack and ship it in bulk? The other question I had is, what is lingerie typically made out? So that's two.
So can you repeat the question? The packaging and?
Well, the first question was, lace is very delicate. I'm sure you have some. How would you pack that? Would you wind it around a cone and ship it like that? And the second question, just a general question, what is usually your lingerie made out of? Is that made out of nylon usually or other fabrics?
So for the packing, so the liver lace is something to be clear of, so the length of a piece of lace is about 6 yards, okay? So you will never get liver lace on big walls like fabric. The biggest piece you can have is 6 yards. So it's something you really have to put in your mind when you are designing a dress with a pattern. So usually when we're shipping bulk, so we put several pieces together, I will say maximum 5. So we fold them with precaution, and we ship that usually by air because it's very light. So, okay. And we ship that all around the world. As far as lingerie, lingerie is made with lace or not, but we prefer the lace. And so depend, it's usually done with very delicate laces, not cotton laces, because cotton doesn't really suffer to be washed. So, and it's mostly like polyamide mixing with rayon to have something very delicate. And our lingerie client really play with the small eyelashes, which is on the border of the delicate liver lace. So all, as you saw, all the pieces are inspected, and then they correct all the mistakes with a needle by hand.
They do it at that point.
Yes. No. So they fix it as with the needle, recreating the work of the woman who did the laces by hand in the past.
Thank you for your presentation. It's very enjoyable, informative. You mentioned early that part of the inspiration for forming Solstice was overcoming the feminist backlash against feminization, which is kind of absurd, but I'm wondering, do you feel the company succeeded in that sense of helping femininity and romance to go global on the Solstice frequency? I'm going to thank you for just even trying.
So definitely, Solstice is full of contrast, okay? So the feminism movement helped us to reborn and to develop the business. So we have to thank them. And today I think that laces is worn by every woman around the world, and it's just like you cannot see it sometimes because but I think it's something very popular.
It seems like you're spearheading a renaissance in lace. Is there anywhere else in the world that makes lace of the equivalent quality of Solstice?
So of course we are not alone, and which is good, because we need the industry to survive, and so there's only few lace companies who still exist. So it's interesting because our competitors in France are in the same village. So it's 6,000 people village, and the biggest competitors is in the same town. So which is interesting. So except France, there is liver lace, even so few liver lace, I will say, even in the US. And it's interesting, it's necessary to have competitors, because all the step and the supplier for our looms need to be there. And if they have only one client like Solstice, how can they survive? So I think competition is good. So Le Sage actually is mostly embellishment on laces. So they will buy our lace, and then they will embellish that the beautiful laces with their know-how, which is amazing, and the tradition of François Le Sage, and all the materials he has collected for many, many years and around the world. So. Yes, that's so basically Le Sage is one of our clients. Yes. And Le Sage is working for Chanel, doing the beautiful embellished fabrics as well. So not so much, because liver looms they don't build anymore liver looms. So basically each time we can find like a piece of a liver looms, or liver looms can be bought, we're just rushing to get it. So because they don't produce liver looms anymore, because it's just a niche. So nobody we're working on a niche. It's not like a huge expanding market, because it's a luxury, people have to appreciate, they have to understand what is liver lace. So we have about 114 liver lace. So competition in China will be knit lace, which is not looking the same. So it's part of our job to educate the designer and to make them understand what how beautiful is the liver lace. And the story of the liver lace, the story of Solstice, will come back in 1879, and with the Frères Machut Company, and the sixth generation is still running the company now. And so all this know-how, this story, this, I will say, the dream behind, and the beauty of the laces, I could have brought to show you the difference between Chinese and liverless or knit laces. It's really, really looking different. There is, because some designer, for price point reason, they may go to China to buy cheapest lace, but we've noticed that they go there, they're coming back. So depends on what they want to do with their brand. And I think that the consumer and the woman who are buying the lace, they know what is beautiful, and you cannot trick them.
Untrained eye discern the better lace, the solstice lace.
Can you repeat the beginning of the question?
How can the untrained eye discern the solstice lace compared to a not as good of a quality lace?
Okay. So first of all, the solstice lace, the liver lace, you will see that there is a lot of details, and the design is going to pop up from the ground, from the tulle. And the top of that, you have as well the beautiful eyelashes, which are on the border of the lace. We call that scallops, as it is done on your dress. And all these details make a huge difference, and really giving some texture to the lace, and not looking flat like a knit lace.
Okay.
Thank you.
Oh, okay. I don't know if that, yes, that's bad. We'd like, first of all, to thank Sandrine Bernard so much for speaking,
for explaining
the complexity and beauty of lace. So we've been thrilled to have her here this evening. And we want to acknowledge and thank her. And to do this, the executive director, Victoria Dengel, is going to make a presentation.
Yes, and Sandrine, I also want to say on behalf of the General Society of Mechanics and Tradesmen, thank you for this presentation. It was wonderful, fascinating. Thank you for introducing us to the people who make the product. I mean, that was so great to see those devoted people that create this art, so thank you. And thank you for keeping it alive with your daily work. And on behalf of the General Society of Mechanics and Tradesmen, we present you with this plaque for your participation in the General Society Artisan Lecture Series, so thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Also making you an honorary member of the library.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Big surprise.
And then just the plaque and that beautiful picture that I love. So thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
And to all of your team with you today. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yes, thank you also very much to
Sarah
for her work.
We want to invite you now to join us and our speaker for some wine and cheese, and to thank you very much for attending. This marks the end
of our Artisan Lecture Series, but we do hope you will return in September. Thank you very much. Bye.